Let's get some hands-on experience with error handling and rest. I'll start by creating a new project called Errors and my terminal now. And then I'll open up this project in VS Code. I'll open up the main.rs file and start by looking at an example with the panic macro. Inside of the main function, I'm going to go ahead and get rid of this println line and use the panic macro. And inside of that, I will have the text farewell. And then go ahead and close that with a semicolon. I can run the program using cargo run. And then I'll see that the program panicked at line 2 with the message farewell. So now let's look at another example that doesn't explicitly throw a panic, but will ultimately result in an unrecoverable state. So what I want to do on line 2 is remove this panic statement. And I'm going to then specify a vector named v. And this vector is going to have the values 0, 1, 2, and 3. On the next line, I will use a print statement to go ahead and print out an index of the vector. Let's try to print out the index of 6. So let's go ahead and see what happens when we do this now. After running this program, I see that the program panicked because of an index out of bounds. So panics can be thrown in programs when they reach an unrecoverable state, like you see here. Whether or not we use the panic keyword, sometimes panics will arise in your programs. Now let's look at an example where we use the option enum, where absence of a value is a possibility and can either return some or none as a value. So I am going to go ahead and comment these lines out here for now since they are throwing a panic. So what I'm going to do is define a new variable called fruits, and this is going to be a vector of different fruits. So let's go ahead and put some fruits in our vector. We're going to have a banana, an apple, and a coconut. And then I'm going to close that with a semicolon. So now what I want to do with this vector is to access fruits. I want to say let first is equal to fruit.get zero. So I just want to go ahead and grab the item in that zero index. And then I can say println. And I want to grab the first variable and print that out there. Then let's say that I have a variable called third, and I want to go ahead and get the third item in the fruits vector. So for this, I can say fruits.get2. And then similarly, I'll go ahead and print that out like this. And add a semicolon at the end. And then for one more example here, I want to try to access a vector's non-existent index. So let's go ahead and say let non_existent is equal to fruits.get. And we can just throw any index that we want in here, but something that's obviously just not going to be existent in our vector. And then on the next line, I'll go ahead and print out that value. Let me go ahead and run this. So I see printed out some banana, some coconut, and then finally none. Since a value exists at a specified index, like it does with the first and the third items, it's going to print out the actual value. So it's using that option sum value variant. If the index is out of bounds, like it is with the non-existent variable, it's going to access the option none value variant and return none. So this is a good example here of seeing this option enum in action. So I'm going to look at one more example of using the result enum. I will first go ahead and comment out this example here. Within the result enum, we'll return okay if there's a value or error if there's an error. Outside of the main function at the top of the file, I am going to import the standard library fs and use file. And then inside of the main function after the commented code, I want to define a new variable called left. F is going to be equal to file open, and then I'm going to put the name of the file within the quotes here. After that, I want to say let F is equal to match F, and then I'll use the result enum to try to unwrap the file contents. So I'm going to say okay file, and then return the file if in fact there is a file found. Otherwise, this will result in an error, and then the program will panic. And I can say that we can't open the file, and then let's print out that error after that. And then I'll go ahead and add a semicolon at the end of this. And let's try to run the program as is to go ahead and see the output now. After running the program, I see that thread main panicked, can't open the file, and the message is no such file or directory. I also know that this error is coming from line 22. So this is just one way of how you can use this match statement where I either return an okay or an error. Something else that I want to go ahead and do though is show examples for how we can use the unwrap and expect helper methods. I can go ahead and get rid of this match statement here, and let's go ahead and try to use the unwrap helper method just like that and see what happens now when we run the program. So this also results in a panic. At line 18, since there is no such file or directory, this is much less code needed for essentially the same result output that we get here. Another way that we can handle the situation is to use the expect helper method. Instead of using unwrap, I can go ahead and call expect here. And what's different about expect than unwrap is that I can go ahead and add a message here to provide a little bit more context in case of a panic. So I can say fail to open hello.txt. And now let's go ahead and run the program again. And notice that this error is a little bit different. Here I have this message, failed to open hello text that I defined. I also then have no such file or directory. So really the convenient thing here is being able to specify an extra message that makes it a little bit more clear if this were to panic where it's happening in the program. So it can definitely save you some time debugging. When integrating error handling in your programs, consider which of these options makes the most sense for your use case. As you become more familiar with Rust, I recommend trying out multiple ways of error handling to decide what works best in different scenarios.